a lot of people, they think that immediately they pick up a new hobby or a new craft, they have to make money from. No, 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 no. You've got to master the basics before you can sort of go doing all that. And it takes time to master the basics. And if you're picking up something that you say, okay, this is going to take me 2 years to learn. Oh, I'll be 50 when I'm finished. Well, you're going to be 50 anyway. Why not be 50 with extra skills?
Hey there, I'm Goli Kalkaran, and this is Lessons from a Quitter, where we believe that it's never too late to start over. No matter how much time or money you've spent getting to where you are, if ultimately you are not happy, then it's time to get out. If you're feeling stuck and you feel like there's gotta be more, there's gotta be a way to feel fulfilled and excited about what you do, then this is the podcast for you. Each week, I will sit down with an inspiring guest who quit their professional career in order to forge their own path and create a life that they love. Hi, guys. Welcome back to another episode of Lessons from a Quitter. I am so excited to have you here. And if you're new, know that I am so honored that you're listening in. You can reach out to me through the website, lessonsfromaquitter.com. I have a newsletter I send out every week that is just like scientific tips and tricks on motivation and how to overcome fear and help you on your jump. So sign up at the website, or you can find me on Instagram at Lessons from a Quitter. Send me a DM. Let me know you listen. I love hearing from you guys. I am so excited about today's episode. Dawn Lewis's story is so unique and so different and so cool and really kind of shows what is possible. And so I can't wait to dive in. But one of the things that her story highlights, which I really was excited to talk about on the podcast, is this idea of just doing things that we love, not because we want to build a business, not because we need to create another source of income, but just because we find enjoyment. I know that most of my guests talk about leaving their career to find another career, and that's understandable. Most of us need to make money, and so I get it. But, you know, as you get older, you just stop doing things that you like. And I think in our society, in Western culture, in capitalism, we put so much emphasis on productivity and being busy and proving yourself, like proving that you're good enough. You're a good enough mom. You're a good enough employee. You're a good enough business person, whatever it is. In this Instagram and Pinterest world now, we have to prove that everything we do is great and we're all building an empire. And like, it just doesn't have to be like that. And I really want that to be a message of this podcast, is that, you know, maybe you do keep your day job and you do something on the side. You just start doing something that you like, and it doesn't have to have an end goal. It's just something that like gives you some joy. And that in and of itself is so powerful and can open up so many things for you and can lead you to so many places. But we don't take that time because we jam pack our schedule with so many other things. And it's something that I've seen. You know, we had Qin Qing on the podcast, and she talked about how, you know, she just took a bunch of classes and found calligraphy and loved it and turned it into a business. And we've heard that story a number of times. And I really think if you sometimes take that pressure off of having to find the next thing or having to find that $1 million idea, then it makes things more organic and easier, and it just allows you to kind of find where you fit in. And that is exactly what Dawn did. Dawn started out in the corporate world, and she'll talk about her job. She actually loved it, but she ended up leaving the corporate world when she had her first daughter, and her plan was to go back when her kids were in school, when they started, you know, after like 4 or 5 years. She ended up having another daughter, and what happened is both of her children have special needs. They are on the autistic spectrum and they needed more attention. And so she ended up staying home with them for a lot longer than she had anticipated. And it wasn't until they went to high school that she started having free time. And what she did next was, you know, just delve into her love of crafting. She decided to volunteer to teach crafting at her local community center just so she could connect with other people. And through that, she'll talk about how, you know, each step led her to the next. She is now a professional crafter. I mean, did you even know that was a thing I didn't. And actually, Dawn didn't when she started out. But now she's a professional crafter, a vlogger, and podcaster based out of New South Wales, central coast of Australia. She has worked in the Australian craft industry for well over a decade, creating projects for craft magazines and brands across a variety of craft mediums. She's hosted an Australian paper crafting television show. She's spoken at conferences and been in magazine. I mean, she's done it all. And she now has a business. She has an online store selling craft supplies. She teaches. She does a bunch of stuff. She just launched the Craft Room podcast. But again, it's just a testament to, like, if you take the time to cultivate your passions, those things can lead to places that you never could have imagined. And even if they don't lead to a business, it's worth putting in the time to find things that light you up. Because after all, like, that is the point, right? Feeling fulfilled, feeling happy. And we put way too much emphasis on money and trying to get more and more and more and more and not really realizing, like, what it is that we need to fulfill us. I think her story is such a good one for that topic. And so without further ado, let's jump in and talk to Dawn. Hi, Dawn. Thank you so much for joining me today.
Thank you for having me. I'm very excited to be here.
I am so excited to have you because I cannot wait to get into what a professional crafter actually does. So we will get to that exciting part. But I like to start kind of back before you transition into all the exciting things that you're doing now. And I was wondering if you could kind of tell us what your career looked like. I know you took some time off after you had kids. So before you had kids, what were you doing?
Well, before I had kids, I was working as a secretary, admin, payroll, all that fun paperwork kind of stuff in offices. I worked for a recruitment company. I worked for a big accounting firm. I worked for an insurance firm and I loved it. I would type up people's resumes and answer phones. It was busy and paperwork and being organized. I loved it to death.
Oh, really? So you did love it. So what made you kind of get out of that field?
Well, I took some time off when my first daughter was born. And when she was about 6 months old, I went back to work 2 days a week. We had this fantastic dynamic in my house where my husband worked shift work. So he worked Wednesday through Sunday and I worked Monday, Tuesday. And it worked really, really well for us. It came up to the time where my second child was due and they were struggling to find things for me to do in the office. Like, I was unfiling. So I was about to turn 30. I was about to have this extra baby and my husband was offered a new job. And when we sat down and we looked at it, his new wage was the equivalent of his old wage plus my wage. Oh. So I quit.
Right. Nice. And was that something though, like that you wanted to do or was it because it made sense? Cause now you didn't, you know, have to work and it might have made sense to stay at home. But I know this is a decision that a lot of women struggle with. And since you did love your job, was it a question that you like grappled with or was it kind of an easy one for you?
At the time, it was an easy one. My oldest daughter was not what you would call a sleeper. And she was a lot of hard work. She was 2 at the time. Yeah, it was a lot of hard work. And I'm very practical. I looked at the numbers and I figured that at 30 with 2 small children, the chances of me going and getting another job like in admin secretarial office was just going to be so problematic that when I looked at the numbers, we just went, well, great. I'll just stay home with the kids until the youngest starts school and then I'll go back to work. Little did I know that that was never going to happen.
Okay. Well, that's an interesting point though, because I think a lot of people have that vision that like, I'll stay home while they're young and then I, you know, will hopefully go back. I think a big fear is like, can I go back into the workforce? Will I get hired when there is a gap on my resume? It seems like that was your plan. So what happened to that?
Well, I didn't exactly plan for it to happen, but I had 2 daughters and both are on the autism spectrum. one with extreme anxiety and possibly ADHD, and the other one with developmental delays and learning disabilities and definitely ADHD and ODD. So we've got all the acronyms going on in my house, right? And but they, when they were little, I didn't know. I didn't find this out until my oldest was in high school. Wow. So I knew I was grappling with something unusual, but I didn't have a marker to weigh it up against, because I was the first of my generation in my family to have kids, being the oldest. So I have cousins who had kids, but right. their kids were like, well, my cousins were way older, and I was like 9 when my cousin had her baby. So right. I wasn't tuned in, and I didn't realize what I was dealing with, but it was hard work.
Yeah, I bet. It just raises a good point. I really want to like highlight what women and mothers especially go through in kind of figuring out work and balance. And it's funny because there's so many parts to it and there's so many opinions. And I know a lot of women feel pressured to stay. I was just reading an article from a woman that was saying that every woman should make their own money, like hands down. And the reason I have a problem with those is because like everyone's situation is different. And what you're saying, you know, it's like when you have 2 children that have needs that need to be met, it's very difficult, you know, and a lot of times, even if you did want to work, sometimes it's not possible because there's other things in your life come up that have to be addressed. And so I can imagine that that must have been, parenting 2 children is a ton of work already. And then having all of that on top of it could not have been easy.
Well, I didn't know any different. It was just normal. It was our normal for our household. But motherhood is definitely not one size fits all. I mean, we have all got to do what works with our relationship, which works in our household, which works with our kids. I mean, you know, I parent my kids so differently to the way that other people do, and others can't comprehend why I do what I do, but it works for my right. kids. And I learned fairly early on to just trust my gut and do what worked for us, because I just had to survive. I had to make sure my kids survived and became functioning adults, which is the stage I'm at right now.
That's the best parenting advice anybody can ever give, is like, you just have to figure out what works for you.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. So you end up staying at home past, you know, when they're in school, and now they're entering adulthood. And so at some point, did you start considering getting another job or joining the workforce, or maybe trying to do something on the side to bring in extra money?
Well, my first thought was, I used to pick up bit work. So if there was, you know, a little bit of this or a little bit of that going, I've always been really entrepreneurial. Like during high school, I would sew clothes for the kids in my school to wear to the school discos. And, you know, I've washed wedding cars and I've ironed clothes and I've house sat. I've done all sorts of weird bit pieces. And so I figured I could just do something like that to sort of get us through. So I did ironing from home and any bit work that I could do. I mean, back in those days, the internet was infancy. I didn't even have the internet connected at home. It was, you know, if I wanted to use it, I had to go to my mum and dad's house to use it. So it occurred to me that there was a possibility with this internet thing, but I really didn't get into that until, you know, quite a way down the line. But it was around about the time where my youngest was about 1.5, a job came available. I heard there were jobs going, they were looking for teachers at my local scrapbooking store. And I thought, oh, I could do that. Maybe a few years prior, I wouldn't have thought I could do that. But I've always wanted to be a teacher, much to my parents' great horror. Halfway through my final year of high school, I said, yeah, I'm not going to university. I don't want to do that anymore. But I've always been a teacher. It's in me. I can't help it. It's one of my favorite things to do. So what I'd been doing, rather than looking for a job, I'd been looking for something to keep me busy. The local church hall was kind of going empty, and I'd grown up in that environment. I knew the people who were there. And I said, hey, what would you think if I used this hall a couple of hours once a week as a community craft thing? I just wanted to meet people and maybe share my skills, because I loved the craft. I've done it my whole life. So they said yes.
Oh, wow.
So I ran these not-for-profit classes. I just charged them what the materials cost, and I'd run these two-hour Friday night classes, and then we expanded into Friday mornings. I started teaching folk art painting after I started learning it, and some of the night girls wanted to learn. So I went twice a day, once a week, and the kids had fun. We had a great service that our local council provided where someone would come and mind the kids. It cost us like $1 or $2 each. We chipped in. So the kids were happy. We got some downtime. Some of my closest friends are women that I met running that group, and it built my teaching skills. I learned way more from them than they learned from me. I learned a lot about dealing with different students, different types of people. And so when this scrapbooking teacher job came up at the local store, I jumped at it.
I love that. You know, I think so often we put like an emphasis on finding work or paid work and figuring out like being so serious about like what we have to do with our lives. And I've heard so many stories now through this podcast of people that started things just for the love of it, just have fun, just add something to their own life. And then that ended up leading them into, you know, a bigger career or a business. And I think if so many more of us just followed our own like curiosities and did things that we enjoyed doing, like not only does that make your life more fulfilled because you're doing something you enjoy, but it really does kind of open up your eyes to maybe opportunities or ideas that you never had. So I love that that is how you got started.
Yeah.
And so you go for this teaching job, and then what happens then?
Amongst a handful, they took on about half a dozen of us, and we worked at this scrapbooking store, designing classes, working with the product that was in the shop. And I loved it. I just loved it. And I met some great people, and I got to do what I liked all the time. And I thought, this is insane, because my husband would get home from work and then I would go to work. So we rarely had to find a sitter or ask a family to look after the girls, because we tag teamed, and we'd been doing that pretty much since our oldest was 6 months old. We tag team parented, you know, it's practically one's walking in the door and the other one was walking out the door. But it was a little bit of extra money. I got a store discount on the things I was going to buy in there anyway. And it was fantastic fun. And it really cemented for me that I enjoyed teaching people to unleash their creativity. It didn't matter what the medium was. Mm-hmm. Everyone's got creativity in them.
Yeah. Absolutely. And I think that we all do, but we tend to, I don't know, as we get become adults, put that stuff to the side. And I think a lot of us, if we're not quote unquote at it, or, you know, we don't see it as one of our skills, you know, if like we're not a painter or I'm not a, you know, whatever, fill in the blank, we tend not to do it.
Yep. I have very strong opinion on that. Is that craft is learnable. Talent is nice, but everything about craft is learnable.
Right.
And that's just very exciting to me, because my husband draws beautifully. Both of my daughters are incredibly talented artists. I can't draw. I don't see a character in my head. I can't bring it to life with a pencil on paper. But craft, you can teach anybody craft.
We had like Sheena Chang on the show, and she was saying how she was taking a bunch of classes when she was trying to come out of law, and, you know, just fell in love with calligraphy when she took this first class. But when she talks about it on her own blog, I mean, she was like, you know, I was really bad at it in the beginning. And it's like, you just learn it. You keep doing it. And I think that's what gets lost. Like, sure, there's some people that are talented artists and they have a natural God-given ability. But a lot of us, you know, if we put in the hours, I don't know why we get to a point where we think we're too old, right? Like, it's like kids, you only make your kids practice piano. Well, if you practice piano, the same thing, like if I practice piano for the next 5 years, I'll become really good at piano, but like, I don't do it. And so I think, I don't know, we get so focused on our lives and our jobs and what we have to do with our families that we kind of put aside all creative work. And so I agree that we all do have creativity if we allow ourselves the space to just like dabble in it for the sake of dabbling without like needing to be good or needing to make it into a career.
Yeah, exactly. A lot of people, they think that immediately they pick up a new hobby or a new craft, they have to make money from. No, 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 no. You've got to master the basics before you can sort of go doing all that. And it takes time to master the basics. And if you're picking up something that you say, okay, this is going to take me 2 years to learn. Oh, I'll be 50 when I'm finished. Well, you're going to be 50 anyway.
Exactly.
Why not be 50 with extra skills?
Oh my God, absolutely. Yes. Okay. So you start teaching these classes and you're making a little bit of extra money. And how does that go to you becoming a professional crafter?
Well, there's more than one thing happening at once. So I'd been taking folk art lessons, learning painting with acrylic paints, and I went to a big craft show. Our craft shows here aren't quite as big as the ones that you guys have over there, but for us, it was a big one. And I met a lady. She was there promoting the Folk and Decorative Artists of Australia Association, FDAA for short. And she was such a delight to talk to. And before I knew it, I joined the association. And then she also put me on to a more local one. They were sort of more based in Sydney. It was a long trek to get to their meetings, but I still went because they were cool ladies and all the famous folk artists were there. But I also joined the local association. And it was through volunteering on the committees and turning up and volunteering at events and really getting involved with the committees that some great opportunities came about. So I had a great experience teaching my volunteer classes and at the scrapbooking store. And meanwhile, I was painting things and to participate in the big sales at the big craft shows where you could make some very big money. You had to volunteer. You had to turn up and help on the day. And that was never a chore because everyone was so fun. And, you know, you're surrounded by craft. What more could I want, right? Right. And there was this one particular year where I was volunteering and a lady came up to the sales desk where I was sitting and she asked to speak to the president of the association. And she had a list and she said, I'm looking for someone to promote our new budget paint range. I've jotted down codes from, you know, all the artists whose work is here that I like. I was wondering, you know, if you could see if they're interested, put them in touch with me. Here's my card. And I snuck a look at the list when no one was looking and I was a bit sad because my code wasn't on the list. But a couple of weeks later, I had a phone call from the president. This was the big turning point that pushed me from hobbyist into the industry. She said, oh, a lady came into the show and was looking for artists. I said, I know, I saw her. I'm not on the list. And she said, yeah, but everyone who was on the list is already repping for other paint companies. And she said, these guys, this is just right up your alley. I've told her you're calling her today. Mm-hmm. So here's her number. You have to call her today. And I completely freaked out because this was the real deal. This was a big company with a really recognizable brand name here in Australia. And there's a voice in your head that says, you can't do this.
Yeah.
You're a fake. They'll find out you'll never work in the industry. But I wanted it so badly. I told that voice, no, you're just going on hold. I muted it for a bit. I rang her an hour and a half later. I got off the phone with an appointment to go into their warehouse for an in-person meeting. So I did that a few days later. I walked out of there half a day later with a car full of product because not only did they distribute paint, but they did embroidery kits, cross-stitch kits, and all sorts of, like, you name it, craft-wise, crochet and knitting, all of these things, they did it all. And as she was showing me around, I'm like, oh, this is cool. She's like, oh, do you embroider? Oh, yes. And by the time I was done walking around, she'd realized I was this great resource because I was across every single craft item that they sold. So I worked with them for a really long time. It was a company called Brand Corp, and they distributed to Australia's big craft chain stores. So you guys have Michaels and Hobby Lobby and Joanne. Right. Ours is called Spotlight. We have another one called Lincraft, but Spotlight's the big one.
Right.
And so they distributed all of these products to these stores all over the country. So that was the start of it. I went in, I did a trade show. She said after I was done, they've never sold so much paint to their retailers and they just kept booking me for gigs and I became a paid professional.
Oh my goodness. So does that mean like you went to the trade shows for them and sold for them at their trade shows? A little unclear on how you worked for them.
At the beginning, they had these little in-house trade shows. So it was in their warehouse, in their big display room where all the products were laid out. And they just had me come in and sit and paint and talk to people. I did that. And then they would just get me to come in, like they said, oh, we've got an extra batch of paints that have come in. Can you come in and swatch them? I thought, can't you swatch them yourself? Sure, I'll come in. Pay me to do that. And so towards the end of my time with them, they eventually closed down, just changes in the industry. I guess it was parts of the business were sold off to different places. But I did a huge trade show with them, a scrapbooking paper crafting trade show with them, where I got to meet Heidi Swap, who is quite the name in the paper crafting industry. And I was running workshops. I had people coming and saying, can I have a photo with you? It was the weirdest thing on earth. And I was by then getting involved with an Australian paper crafting television show as well. So
wow.
I was designing all sorts of stuff for magazine ads and magazine articles. And
oh my God.
It just snowballed. I painted some teddy bears, which they turned into cross stitch kits, which I stitched and corrected. And I did all the working samples. And I had my own range of cross stitches in our great big chains.
That's incredible. I mean, when you started out, did you even know this stuff was possible? Like, did you know that people get paid to go like sit and paint at a trade show?
I had no idea. My big goal was to have somebody interview me for a profile in a craft magazine. That was my big dream. I wanted to have like Today Meet the Maker kind of thing in this month's magazine. That was my big dream. I had no idea how to achieve it. Oh my God.
This is amazing.
But that was my big dream, which I actually did get to tick.
Yeah, I mean, I bet you got that. And then now you're doing all these incredible things. And I know when we spoke before, you said that you started working on, I believe it was like some kind of crafting TV show or.
Yeah.
So what was that about?
We moved from where we lived about 12 years ago. And so I left the store where I was teaching there. And there was kind of a sister store up here where I live on the Central Coast. I already knew the owner and she was looking for teachers. So I went in and put my hat in the ring and I was taken on as a teacher there. And one day she gave me a call and she said, look, there's this TV show that's coming in to film Rachel Griggs. She's a good friend of mine. I've known her for years and years. She owns a beautiful business called Darkroom Door. She's a photographer, also a stamper. She's married the two and she has the most beautiful business. I adore her work and she's just a delightful person. And she was filming an episode for this TV show in the shop where I taught. And the producer said, well, while I'm in here, do any of your other teachers want to do a segment? And I jumped at it. So I designed a piece using some of the products from Brand Corp, who I was designing for. And I went in and I filmed a segment. I think it was season 3. And because it was strictly a Foxtel show, that's our cable network here, I'd never seen it because we didn't have cable. And I was a little bit, I don't know anything about this show at all, but I did it anyway and I filmed it. And the producer really liked my work and he actually caught up with me at the big scrapbooking trade show a few months later and we filmed another segment, which was really fun. And then I got a phone call the following year saying, he'd like you back on the show again. Are you keen?
That's amazing. That's amazing.
Please. I'd do that for free all day long. So I went into my friend's warehouse where we filmed that particular day and he'd asked me to do two segments. And then right at the end, he's like, oh, can you do another one? So I just pulled one out of the hat and just did a third segment. And I loved it. I thought it was great fun. It's not something I got paid to do. I just did it because it was teaching on a really big level. That was really great fun. And I thought, well, that was great. Wouldn't it be fun if they did another one? But, you know, who knows?
Yeah.
Well, the next year came around. I got a phone call this time from the producer, Tony. And he said, oh, we're doing season 5. Are you interested? Yes, I'm interested. And he said, we're going to take on a host this year and change the format. I'm like, that sounds fantastic. Who's hosting? He said, oh, you are.
Oh, my goodness.
I can't believe it. So I got to go into the big craft magazine offices in Sydney and interview all these amazing paper crafters, some of whom I actually already knew, but I got to meet all these new ladies and show them lots of, you know, talk to them about their work and interview them. And it was just amazing. And I stayed on as host through season 6 and 7. And then we wound it up because getting sponsors was difficult.
Right. But
oh my goodness, it was just the most fun thing.
I bet. And I'm sure that that helps like grow your brand in the craft community. And I'm sure it got you a lot more noticed. And so even if it wasn't like paid.
Well, I handled all of the social media and towards the end, the last couple of seasons, I did get paid. It wasn't a huge amount, but you know, it was a little bit and it helped, you know, for the times. But I had sponsors come in and the sponsors would pay me to do their segments on the show as well. So that was really, really cool. And around about, I think it was season 7, I'd found this stamp brand and I'd been selling a lot of handmade. I had a handmade doll business. And after making the same doll about 3 billion times, I just burned out on that. And I thought, I found this stamp brand and it was really cool. It wasn't available in Australia and international shipping is pretty mad. especially when you take the way how the Australian dollar is quite low most of the time. So I contacted the owner and said, look, I'm doing this TV show. I'd love to use your stuff on the show. Is that all right? And she's like, that would be great, which I did. And I sent her a copy of a link to, you know, the segment when it was available. And I just, out of the blue, I don't know what even possessed me, I said, is there any chance I could be your distributor, like your retailer in Australia? And they said, yes. So I accidentally opened an online store reselling stamps that people couldn't buy in Australia. They loved them. I had the platform of the show to sort of promote them. I was handling the social media, so I could pretty much do what I liked there. And I accidentally opened an online craft supply store.
Accidentally. I love that. Everything that you've said has, in one way or another, been you taking a jump, even though like there's something in you saying like, what are you doing? Or, you know, you shouldn't do this. And I think that is really the important takeaway, is that you don't know where any of this is going. So it's like each thing is kind of leading you to the next. And then the thing is when the opportunity presents itself, you go for it. Cause like the worst that can happen is no. And look at all the incredible things that have happened, you know, I mean, whether it was the TV show or now the stamp business, or even in the beginning with the trade shows and painting and all that stuff. I think for most people, they tend to just wait for someone to offer them something. And there's something to be said for going after it.
I got really lucky in a lot of instances. Things just came across my path. But I had to be in that place in order for that. If I'd not gone out to craft shows and networked and met all the storeholders, I would never have met Laurie. I would never have found the FDAA, and I would never have gotten that gig. So getting out, volunteering, joining associations, and just networking with other crafters. So when I had the doll making business, I was doing local markets, and quite a few years ago, handmade markets were a rarity up here on the coast. So when this one market was started, a local girl found me and said, hey, are you interested in being a stall holder? It was mental. It was the first one on the coast. It was crazy busy. I was selling hundreds of dolls every couple of months, and it was going gangbusters. And it was a social night where it was meet the other stall holders, because when you're working, you don't really, and it's busy, you can't get around and meet people. And we met in this girl's shop. She and I have collaborated since then on so many things. Mm-hmm. And she was a former craft magazine editor. And so she saw something I'd been working on and said, oh, you have to send that in to Handmade Magazine. So I grabbed the email address, I sent it in and said, Marnie said I should send you this. Instantly, the next morning I woke up to a yes, oh my God, when can you send that to me? And I started being published in magazines, like more than one project a month over several magazines. It kept me really, really busy. And that was how I realized my dream of being a featured artist in a craft magazine, because I was across a lot of mediums. She could ring me and say, look, our crochet project hasn't come through. Can you make me something in the next 3 days? And I could.
Yeah.
Because my kids were at school. I was at home. I could do it. It was easy for me to do. I thought, is that all you want? No problem. I can do that. And it paid really well. And I could use those projects later on to make money in a bunch of other ways as well. It was a good investment of time.
That's incredible. I mean, again, I think it's just a testament to like your ability to just keep going after it. And I hear it over and over in most of these interviews, and I see it with a lot of people that are stuck and don't know the step to take. And the way forward is to just like start something. And what you were just saying, I mean, networking is huge. Getting out and meeting people is huge. I mean, I try to stress this as much as possible. And I think, I don't know, maybe I sound like a broken record at this point, but really it is like putting one forward, because if you're waiting for like that whole path, I mean, there's no way you would have known all of the stuff was going to happen. It's just a matter of like trying one thing and then meeting people and making connections and seeing where that goes. And we always want to have like 10 steps ahead, know what everything is going to happen. And I already want to be, you know, this professional artist making money. And it's like, it doesn't work that way. It's still worth it to take those steps.
It is, absolutely. By just starting, you take action and there's always a reward. Every time I take action, especially when I don't want to, I don't feel like it, I'm procrastinating or I'm fearful of what's going to happen next. But anytime I make myself take action, I am always rewarded, always.
That's amazing. I love that. I think that is just such a valuable lesson. And so now do you work full-time as a professional crafter or is it still a part-time?
I do.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it kind of fills my entire day. Right. So I have an online store, which keeps me really, really busy. I have a YouTube channel, which I love because it's that big scale teaching that I can right. do. I teach locally in collaboration with my friend that I met from the markets. Mm-hmm. Her name's Marnie and is a sewing machine mechanic. And she also teaches at our local sewing machine center. And so it's a great collaboration between the three businesses. He has the space and it's good to have classes because it brings people into the store.
Right.
So I do that. Sometimes a couple of days a week. It depends. I do a lot of classes on demand and I teach crochet. I teach embroidery.
My goodness, you are a busy woman.
I am always a busy woman.
I love that.
Yeah, I'm just always doing stuff.
Well, and how great is it that you have created a full-time career doing all the things that you love doing anyways? I think that's everybody's dream. So, I mean, I know we've talked a lot about advice, but is there anything that you would say to somebody that kind of feels, you know, either stuck in a job that they don't want, or maybe they did take time to stay at home and they really want to jump back into something? Anything that kind of has helped you along the way?
Yeah, there's a couple of things. Just because you have this hobby that you love doesn't mean it has to become a business. Because when mm-hmm. you turn your hobby into a business, you need a new hobby.
Right.
I've turned almost every craft that I do into business, but the one I keep for myself is quilting. So I don't create patterns for sale or do quilts for magazines or anything. That's something I keep just for me for fun. So you still need something there's no pressure on.
Mm.
And the other thing is that there's this gap often where you have this vision. It follows very closely on that famous Ira Glass quote about the gap, where you have this amazing vision. And let's face it, you know, our ladies, we've got good taste, but our skills need to catch up to that vision. You've got this picture in your head of how you want things to be that you're making, and you've got to make a lot of stuff. So whatever it is that you want to do, whether it's being a life coach or a yoga teacher, you have to just build this massive body of work. It doesn't mean you have to sell it, but you have to really hone your skills and mm-hmm. get good at it and practice. And at the beginning, I did it for free because I just wanted to learn how to be a good teacher. And these ladies were kind enough to be my guinea pigs and let me teach them for free. And they learned a lot. I learned even more. It's going to take time, patience, but persistence and consistency will get you there. It might not get you where you think you're going to go, but be open to those things that come along.
Yeah, that's actually very true. Yeah. Okay, and where can people find your YouTube channel, or where's the best place for them to find you if they maybe want to reach out?
Very simply, I am at dawnlewis.com.au and there are links to all my socials and everything there on the front page. I'm on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, and I just started podcasting, you know, because the world yeah. needs a craft podcast, I thought.
I'm sure it doesn't. What's the name of the podcast that they can look it up?
It is The Craft Room Podcast.
The Craft Room Podcast. Perfect. Well, I will link to all those in the show notes. Dawn, I think what you've done is incredible, and I think it's just a testament to what is possible in today's day and age, and you really can turn the things that you love into your business. So it's very inspiring, and I'm so thankful for you that you came on and talked to us about it. So thank you.
Oh, thank you so much for having me. I hope somebody out there, if they're stuck, just go for it. Have a go, because you'll love it.
Thank you so much, Dawn.
Thanks, Golly.
Thank you. How cool was Dawn? I could talk to her forever. Her story is so interesting. And here are my three takeaways. One, start exploring your curiosities just for fun. We put so much emphasis on profit and building a business and being productive. And you'd be surprised if you did what you did when you were a kid and just followed the things that you like. It can lead you to some really cool places. Two, network, network, network. And I don't mean in the stuffy kind of way where you're trying to sell yourself. Find a group of people and that you want to invest in, and you will be surprised how much they invest in you. And it comes up a ton on the podcast. I've had so many guests say, like, you know, and then I met this person and they put me in contact with that person. And it seems like it's luck, but it really is just like putting yourself out there and other people wanting to help. And it's an incredible domino effect. And so the more you can do it, the farther you will get. And three, you have to push yourself to do the scary, uncomfortable things. If you don't ask, the answer is always no. So much of Dawn's story was, I was telling myself I shouldn't call, but I still called. Or I went, you know, I put my hand up when they wanted someone to go on TV. And if you don't do those things, you're never going to get these incredible experiences. So you have to push yourself out of that comfort zone. And with that, I will see you guys on the next episode. Thank you so much for listening. I can't tell you how much it means to me. If you liked the podcast, please rate and review us on iTunes. It'll help other people find the show. If you want to connect or reach out, follow along on Instagram and Facebook at Lessons from a Quitter and on Twitter at Quitter Podcast. I would love to hear from you guys. And I'll see you on the next episode.